Hello, this is Simone, and welcome again to A Road Retraveled. In the last episode, we toured St. Peter's Piazza, also the altar of science representing air in the novel and movie Angels and Demons. There, we found the West Ponente that represents air, some amazing pagan and Christian symbols, exorcism formulas, impressive Bernini masterpieces and illusions, as well as a secret Bernini heart. In this episode, we're going inside the Basilica of St. Peter, the largest church in Christendom and one of the holiest places on earth. Hello, this is Simone and welcome to A Road Retraveled's Angels and Demons Tour. Most of us who visit the Basilica have no idea about its incredible history. Why was it built here, and by who? To find out, we have to go back in time nearly 1700 years. Like many other churches in Rome dedicated to martyred saints were built on the spot of their martyrdom, so was St. Peter's. Emperor Constantine built the first Basilica, that's right. This is not the first St. Peter's Basilica. The first was built almost 300 years after St. Peter was crucified upside down in Caligula's circus for his religious beliefs during the reign of Emperor Nero. This basilica was not built on the flat foundations of the circus where Peter was martyred, but 500 feet outside of the circus on a steep slope of the Vatican Hill on top of an existing cemetery where Peter was buried in a trench covered by stones. The profanation of a Roman cemetery was such a criminal offense that not even the highest officials in power would be able to escape the worst penalty possible, not even the emperor. So to build on top of the cemetery, Emperor Constantine covered the tombs and graves with earth to create a flat platform for the foundation. So families who had tombs for generations no longer had access to them. But on the bright side, those buried there would forever be a part of the foundation of the great St. Peter's Basilica. Just as many pagan traditions were adopted by a new faith, so was pagan architecture by the early Christians. The plan Constantine chose for the church was that of a basilica, which was a Roman justice hall. The former judge's throne became the bishop's throne. The assistant judge's benches became those of the ministers. And the altar of Minerva was replaced by Christ. There are no records or frescoes to tell us what the basilica looked like, but what we do know is that it was lavishly decorated with gold, silver, and precious stones. It was constantly repaired until year 1500 when Pope Julius II decided the basilica needed to be replaced. And in a controversial move only matched by Constantine 1200 years earlier, the Pope demolished the old basilica. A competition was then held for the best design for the new basilica, and Donato Bramante won the commission. In 1506, Pope Julius II ceremoniously laid the first stone of the foundation. Both the Constantinian and the present basilica were constructed in such a way that the papal altar is positioned directly over the original tomb of Peter. Built large enough to hold 60,000 people, is the largest interior of a Christian church in the world, and regarded as one of the holiest Christian sites. The dome that defines the basilica rises to a total of 448 feet from floor up, making it the tallest dome in the world. In diameter, at 464 feet, it's just slightly smaller than the Pantheon in Rome and the Duomo in Florence, both which have been great inspiration for the design and studied carefully for construction methods that were applied to St. Peter's Dome. And who better to be in charge of this ultimate masterpiece of architecture? None other than Michelangelo. Although he died before the dome began to take shape, his plans were followed to the T. It took 120 years, several popes, more money than God, and an elite group of artists like Bramante, Michelangelo, Raphael, and Bernini to complete the basilica. It's also said that the basilica may have been partially funded by selling indulgences or buying forgiveness from the church, a controversial practice that was deemed by the likes of Martin Luther as corrupt. The sophisticated, impressive, and uplifting Baroque facade was created by Moderno, the same architect that designed the first fountain in the piazza. When you look at the facade, there's a lot going on there. It's topped with 13 statues of Christ the Redeemer and his 12 apostles overlooking the piazza. Right underneath is an inscription that reads, Paul V Borghese, Roman Pontiff in the year 1612, the seventh of his pontificate, erected in honor of the Prince of Apostles. I'm telling you, these popes took credit for their deeds seriously. The Loggia of the Blessings is where a new pope is announced and gives a Urbi et Orbi blessing. The clock on the left that gives the exact time in Rome is called the Italian clock. The clock on the right, with only one hand showing the European mean time, is called Ultramontano. The wrong time on the north clock is an alleged attempt to keep the devil guessing about the day and the hour. I suppose it was assumed the devil didn't have elsewhere in Rome to look for the time, but here. Before you even enter the basilica, you'll notice guards wearing brightly colored uniforms and holding pikes. They may look like pretty boys, but let me tell you, they're lethal. They are the Swiss Guards, the Pope's elite bodyguards from Switzerland. The Pope credited to organizing this group of guards was Pope Julius II, which he did so on the same year of the construction of this basilica. You see, the Pope wasn't pleased that Rome's nastiest baron had better protection than he did. So he decided to build the papal army in agreement with the Swiss Confederacy that provided him with a personal army of 6,000 men. This army lasted until 1825, when the number dwindled down to 100 men. That includes 4 officers, a chaplain, 23 non-commissioned officers, 2 drummers, and 70 halberdiers. That's a 16th century term for a man holding a spear, or a halberd. So okay, if you're also wondering what fashion designer would dress the papal army in such colorful fufu uniforms, well, many versions are floating around. Some say it was Raphael, some say it was inspired by drawings by Michelangelo, but it's generally credited to Jules Ripond, who created these more modern uniforms in 1914. Either way, it's apparent that none of these men were actual fashion designers. Between the facade and the interior of the Basilica is a portico that contains an 18th century statue of Charlemagne on one end. The northernmost bronze door is a holy door and is by tradition only open for great celebrations such as the Jubilee years. The door in the center was preserved from the old basilica. It was too small to fit in this new space, so panels were added at the top and the bottom. Known as the Filarete door after the artist's nickname, it has 6 panels that depict events relating to St. Peter and St. Paul. The door to the far left is a door of death, because its traditional use was as an exit for funeral processions, and also because its large relief panels depict death. When you enter the basilica, prepare yourself to be astonished. The distance from here to the far end is a staggering 2 football fields. When Bernini created the piazza, he gave it the impression of being larger than it actually is. But for the church, he gave it the impression that it's quite smaller than it actually is, bringing the heavens and earth together. If you look ahead at a bronze canopy above the altar, the baldacchino, that is 7 stories tall. The cupids on the holy water stoops are over 6 feet tall. All of the statues are not the same height. You see, the further up they go, the bigger they get, by as much as 5 feet. This gives the impression that all of the statues are the same size. When you walk around and see paintings, they're not made with paint. They're made using tiny mosaics. This way, elements and flashlights don't damage them. While still standing by the entrance, look down. The round disc of red porphyry is where King Charlemagne was crowned Holy Roman Emperor in 800 AD inside the former basilica. He was the first of 21 emperors to kneel on this same disc. Another statue that was taken from the old Constantinian Basilica is that of St. Peter. And some say he actually looks like a senator, so it may have been a statue of an ancient Roman senator that was later attributed to St. Peter. Either way, for centuries, people have come to rub his foot until there's really nothing left but a stump. Here are some interesting stats. The basilica is 275 square feet or 6 acres. It has 44 altars, 11 domes, 778 columns, 395 statues, and 135 mosaics. The nave is 613 feet long and the transept 460 feet wide. No way, this cannot be the largest church in the world. For good measure, check out the markings on the floor indicating how it measures against the other large churches in the world, including St. Peter's in London, the Duomo in Florence, and even St. Patrick's in New York. And just in case you're not convinced by now who this church is dedicated to, wrapped around the entire church in 7-foot-tall letters is just about every quote from Jesus to Peter written in the Bible. Once inside, you'll feel immediately drawn to the altar underneath the dome. By looking up at the dome, it's impossible to imagine its height actually measures the length of an entire football field. The Statue of Liberty could easily stand underneath it, even a space shuttle. Decorated in mosaic, it looks like it's made of gold. When Gian Lorenzo Bernini first visited St. Peter's as a young boy, he was so moved that he aspired to one day build a mighty throne for the apostle. His wish came true when Pope Urban VIII hired him in 1626 as architect for the basilica, where Bernini spent the next 50 years thinking of bigger and grander designs to adorn the church. So incredible his work was that he's always been regarded as one of the greatest, if not the greatest, Baroque architect and sculptor. One of his first commissions was to design the baldacchino above the altar. At nearly 100 feet tall and 90 tons, it's probably the largest piece of bronze in the world. It has 4 huge twisted columns decorated with olive leaves and bees. The bees are the symbol of Pope Urban's Barberini family. The face of the Pope's beloved niece and baby are also on the columns. It starts with the figure being represented in different stages of giving birth. And it goes on like that from column to column until the last figure of the baby itself. Flags and tassels appear to blow in the wind, reminiscent of the portable canopies used in Eucharistic processions. But the baldacchino caused a lot of controversy because it was suspected to be the recipient of bronze pillaged from classical buildings like the portico ceiling of the Pantheon. But of course, the Pope denied it. Nonetheless, the Pope and his Barberini family did not escape people's scorn with the infamous public sentiment that is still repeated today. What the barbarians didn't do, the Barberini did. Bernini had another brilliant idea. He used Bramante's big pillars to create niches for 4 very important statues that represent 4 precious relics the church is in possession of. Saint Veronica is the woman who, according to tradition, wiped the face of Jesus on his way to the cross. The veil she used is said to have been imprinted with the face of Jesus. and a relic piece of fabric brought from Jerusalem during the Crusades is believed to be Veronica's veil due to an impression of a face of a bearded man. The name Veronica derives from the words vero and icon, which means true image. It's also in this area where Pope Julius II laid the first stone of this basilica on April 18, 1506. St. Andrew was Peter's brother who was martyred at the Andrew Cross in Greece, and it contained some of his bones. But in 1966, it headed back, no pun intended, to the Church of St. Andrew in Patras by Pope Paul VI as a sign of friendship with the Greek Orthodox Church. St. Ellen is a mother of Emperor Constantine and a devout Christian. She is said to have sought the true cross, and in the loggia above are fragments of the true cross of Jesus. In her other hand are two nails. St. Longinus, sculpted by Bernini, was a Roman soldier who pierced the side of Jesus on the cross. Longinus converted afterwards, and a relic piece of his lance was given to Pope Innocent VIII in 1492 by Sultan Bajazet.
We have to speak very quietly and show respect to the church. When you come to the Vatican, to St. Peter's, like any other church in Italy, you must follow some simple guidelines. Always make sure that your shoulders and your knees are covered. So if you're wearing tank tops, make sure you bring a shawl. Or if you're wearing skirts, make sure that you are just prepared before you enter here. Either bring a sarong or something, but knees and shoulders have to be covered. And you also have to go through security like an airport, so you can't bring any sharp objects with you. So if you bring any Swiss Army knives, you know, to cut your lunch, you know, for picnics, leave those behind because they will be confiscated. So keep those few guidelines in mind when you enter this holy place and have a magical experience in here.
In the part 2 segment of St. Peter's Basilica, I'll show you what I was surprised to find out was fake inside the church. We'll visit the crypt below where the tomb of St. Peter is and former popes are buried. We'll discover hidden and mysterious images in the marble and wood inside the basilica, check out a beautiful view from the dome, visit Michelangelo's famous Pietà, and talk about the brutal attack it suffered a while back. We'll attend a papal audience and more. Join me next time inside St. Peter's Basilica at the Vatican. Until then, ciao for now!